good? You good, Abby? I think we good. So we got this thing called the Bridge Nation, and one of the reasons why myself, Paul, some of the other folks that some of y'all know them, but or if y'all seen anything that we've done recently, y'all seen Randall, y'all seen Bethany. One of the reasons why we started this is because clearly we have somewhat of a divided nation, and there's a lot of hard topics to discuss. And so we wanted to just provide this platform for those who are actually interested in some serious dialogue about the different issues that we, you know, that our country is experiencing, not just our country, but we as individuals. It's not just about politics. It's not just about government. We'll talk about things like education on here. We'll talk about other things that affect our day-to-day lives, spirituality. We'll talk about relationships. We'll talk about finances. But we want to talk about them in a way that challenges our thinking sometimes, and also at the end of the day will bring us together, kind of bridge the gap, whether you're talking about religious folks and non-religious folks, or whether you're talking about black folks and white folks, or whether you're talking about anybody, you know. How do we overcome the differences that we share? And some of those differences, which may be very real, but still have respect for each other, man. So that's what we hope to do here. You know, right now we're starting off with this kind of podcast format, but we also eventually hope we want to start writing articles and a couple of other things, you know. Well, we're not going to try to force the situation. We're just going to start with this and master this. So first thing that we want to talk about kind of is, well, usually we start off our first segment, Paul, with some random stuff. But in the honor of Martin Luther King Jr., since we just celebrated Martin Luther King on this past Monday, I'll let you start off with something that you saw this week so that the people might be interested in hearing from the famous, the one of my heroes, Dr. Martin Luther King.
Yeah, man, in light of the celebration of his birthday this weekend, I found this really good quote that I thought could be good to just kind of kick the conversation off. It's from a letter from a Birmingham jail, 1963. And he goes, "First, I must confess that over the past few years, I have been greatly disappointed with the white moderate. I have almost reached a regrettable conclusion that the Negro's great stumbling block in his stride toward freedom is not the white citizen's counselor or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate, who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, 'I agree with you in the goal you seek, but I cannot agree with your methods of direct action,' who paternalistically believes he can set the timetable for another man's freedom, who lives by a mythical concept of time, and who constantly advises the Negro to wait for a more convenient season. Shallow understanding from people of goodwill is more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. Lukewarm acceptance is much more bewildering than outright rejection." What do you think about that, man? That last, those last couple lines really, really stood out to me.
Well, what exactly? MJ, I see you. What's up, MJ? What exactly stood out to you when you read that? Like, why was that so powerful? Powerful enough, in your opinion, to even bring that to our attention?
Well, it's like people have, like he said, people have good intentions. You know, not just white people. In this context, he's talking about white people. But, you know, people have generally, well, not generally, but people have good intentions. But it's worse if, like he said, like the people with good intentions don't fully understand what the real issues are and how to solve those issues. Like, it's worse to have those kind of people than to deal with the people who you know are just completely against you, you know what I'm saying? And who you know that they're going to disagree with you, you know, regardless, they have adversarial, you know, kind of viewpoint towards you. So it's easier to deal with those people than to deal with the people who, well, maybe they'll agree with you, maybe they have good intentions, but like, they're ignorant of it, or they don't even think about it, or they don't realize that, like, what the real issues are, you know what I'm saying?
So, and I think, go ahead, my bad.
No, I was going to say, I think that that's the majority of people generally, you know what I'm saying? I think most people are
MJ agrees with you.
Yeah, I think most people are just comfortable, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Like, they're just comfortable doing what they're doing, you know, in their bubble, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, we talked a lot about bubbles this last mm-hmm. election. Mm-hmm. And I think people just are, you know, it takes a certain amount of discomfort mm-hmm. to kind of get out of your bubble and to, you know, kind of wake up to the realities that other people might be facing mm-hmm. that you don't have to deal with, you know what I mean?
I think one of the interesting things is that most of us don't understand these things that affect us on a day-to-day basis as much as we probably should, and I think we all would agree. Yeah. And in many ways, I think Martin Luther King could have been talking to all of us, because how many of us truly understand how to play an active role in our government right now? How many of us are like, literally, it's actually pretty difficult, because I've been trying to figure out, like, you know, in the DMV area, where do I go to begin participating actively in government? Where do I go to get understanding? Where do I go to see what has been, to see what policies are up just for my area? Forget nationally, right? Just for my area, and it seems to be difficult. But there is certainly a broad ignorance of an understanding of how do we, of the issues first and foremost, and then how do we approach those issues. And I think that's certainly needed if we're going to, we have to figure out how to get involved in that. And that's one of the things we hope to be able to bring to you one of these days, interview somebody, what have you, so that we can all, like, grow and figure out how do we do this. Altogether, MJ says, people feel if it doesn't affect them, they don't need to advocate for it. And I love that, yeah. Because me being a black person, right, it's very easy for me to talk about issues that directly impact black people. But I also noticed that I think black people, we could have done more with, let's say, the folks over there in Standing Rock, right? I could have myself personally even been more vocal about that, right? Mm-hmm. And now, you know, when we even see these challenges that many in, let's say, middle America are saying that they're facing, you know, with their lack of jobs, you know, there's a large portion of people who voted for Donald Trump, and there's nothing, if you voted for Donald Trump, that's your business, like, mm-hmm. But how do we, one of the initial things that a lot of people want to do is jump on them and say, oh, well, you know, such and such blamed them or what have you, blah, 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 but how do we take initiative and say, you know what are the real issues that you're going through,
right.
How can I understand those issues, and then how can we work together moving forward, yeah. Right, and even if we disagree that there's an issue or something should be an issue, can we discuss it intelligibly? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And not just out of an emotional kind of thing. Because the challenge is that we make most of our decisions based on emotions. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And many of the great, both Donald Trump and Barack Obama actually were good at this in terms of not just saying, let me just give you a bunch of information, yeah. But how do I tap into that emotive element aspect of who you are to get that engaged so that you can make a decision.
Right. And it makes me think of, you know, another famous quote by MLK, that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere.
Mm.
You know, like what you're talking about. Mm. You know, the people of Standing Rock, for example. And, you know, I think that the reality is that I was listening to the podcast earlier. I think we both listened to it, mm-hmm. The Ezra Klein Show. He was interviewing Congressman Keith Ellison, who's running for the DNC chair, Democratic National Committee. And, you know, he was talking about this. Like, ultimately, a lot of the issues that people are facing in middle America and really all around the country, we're all kind of dealing with the same issues. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It's been a kind of a steady decline mm-hmm. over the last 30, 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for people who are just working class, you know what I'm saying, in terms of their economic standing
mm-hmm.
and just kind of the discrepancy between the rich and the poor, you know, the gap has been growing for mm-hmm. a long time. And so everybody's kind of been dealing with the same issues, but it's all about how do we frame those issues, like mm-hmm. you said, you know what I'm saying? How do we tap into not just the emotions of people, but, you know what I'm saying, how do we frame the conversation so people in Kansas or, you know, Michigan or wherever realize that, like, they're facing the same issues that people in urban areas in New York and Brooklyn and those kind of areas are facing, mm-hmm. you know. It's all about jobs, you know, mm-hmm. how do you create jobs, how do you create, you know, gainful employment for mm-hmm. people, you know, give them meaning, give them purpose, those kind of things. And those are issues that everybody's facing, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Now, Donald Trump, and that's why we're talking about framing, you know, how do you frame the discussion? He framed it in a manner where it's like a zero-sum game uh-huh. where, you know, the reason why they're struggling is because, you know, people are coming from overseas and taking their jobs.
Right.
You know,
right.
their jobs are being taken by immigrants and right. people who are coming over and those kind of things. You know, so that's how he framed the discussion, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? So I guess the question is, how do we kind of reframe the mm-hmm. discussion to help people recognize that we're all in this together, you know what I'm saying? Ultimately, we can all prosper together, mm-hmm. you know, and that's another thing that Keith Ellison was saying, that there's enough to go around, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? Like, this country is incredibly prosperous, there's a lot of money, mm-hmm. but it's highly concentrated, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? And so I guess the question is, how do we create a system where everybody can benefit, where everybody, you know, can get what they're worth? You know what I'm saying?
But that's also one of the reasons why it then becomes important for us to figure out how to participate in this political system, right? And not just, because yeah. one of the things that you mentioned about what Keith Ellison was saying was that we have a lot of people who are ready, very much ready to participate in the political system at a time like this, right? When it comes right. to the national elections. But one of the challenges is that national elections only represent one aspect of our politics and our government. Yeah. And as a matter of fact, most of us are engaged when it comes to the presidential nomination and disengaged, you know, as for the next 4 years. Right. So how do you then begin figuring out how to make how to help your government, how to help your local area politics? How do you get things done? How do you pass policies and all these things day after day, 365 days of the year, mm-hmm. right? How do you understand the policies that are going on? Do you even know? Most of us don't even know the names of the representatives in our local area.
Yeah.
Right? We don't know what laws are being passed in our local area.
I know.
You know what I'm saying? When I was in New York, I knew who it was. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But one of the only reasons why I even knew is because while I was, let's say, going to school or what have you, you know, you do something good, a local representative will come to the school or something like that. Mm-hmm. And then I happened to be a musician at the church and of the guy who was one of the deputy county executives of Nassau County, right? Yeah. So that at least put me somewhat in that environment. But aside from that, most of us don't know.
Yeah.
And yeah. I think also on a national level, though, they have to do a better job as far as reaching out to us down here on the ground level. Because even if you go looking for tools to see how can I join or how can I participate, it's very hard to figure that out. You know, it's very hard to figure out what's the first step. Who do I go to as a first step? In terms of my first step to say I'm going to start participating in government and politics.
Yeah. And it's amazing because even in the general elections, like the presidential elections, when you look at like voter turnout in terms of like percentage of people, it's usually like, isn't it like 50-60% usually, like, of the population? Mm-hmm. And so even in those big elections mm-hmm. that people really kind of tune in for, they're still not like an incredible amount of mm-hmm. voter turnout, you know, 90% or more, you know what I'm saying? So, and, you know, much less when you're talking about the state and local mm-hmm. politics, it's way less than that. Like, I've heard like 20%, 25%, you know, people turn out for those. So, you know, I guess that is the question, you know, how do we kind of stay engaged? How do we get engaged, mm-hmm. you know, not just for every 4 years when it's the president, but, you know, how do you become more engaged in terms of, like you said, the local school boards, local politics, you know, your city councils and those kind of things. Because those are really the policies and the laws that are really directly affecting you on a mm-hmm. daily basis. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? That's what people may not realize as much. You know what I'm saying? Like, we all look to the president and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But
with, question for you.
Yeah.
So, in the spirit of the fact that we just had Martin Luther King Day, right? And then also combining that with, I've been hearing reports that Chrisette Michele is supposed to sing, you know, as part of the inauguration festivities, and she's taking a lot of backlash because of that. I want to get your opinion when it comes to, let's say, somebody like her in her position, and when we also think about the implications of that in terms of us working with Donald Trump overall, for those of us who didn't vote for Donald Trump, and not just Chrisette Michele, but people have also been giving Steve Harvey backlash, who else, a number of other people. How do you, what do you think should be, what would be your stance? How would you go about navigating that? Do you think it's cool for her to participate? Do you think that she's wrong for participating, not wrong for participating, and why?
Yeah. Part of me thinks that, you know, at the end of the day, to be able to sing or to participate in a presidential inauguration, it's still a significant event. I mean, regardless, you know what I'm saying? It's the president of the United States. Whether you...
We spill you, Tiff.
Whether you, you know, whether you, what's it called, voted for him or not.
Tiff,
you know,
got a podcast too, by the way.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I don't know if she know that. I know that, but I seen that podcast too.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, it's the office of the president. You know what I'm saying? So regardless, it's an important, significant event. You know what I mean? And I guess the question is, if you participate in it, does that mean that you support the president? You know? And I don't know that that's the case necessarily, but I think that's, it's an opportunity for you to serve your country. And, I mean, you could think of it that way. If I had the opportunity, I'm a musician.
And Paul is a musician, by the way.
If I had the opportunity to...
Well, I'm a musician too, but he does it full time. You
know, like, if we had the opportunity, if they invited us to go play for the inauguration, I think I would go. I mean, I would think about it. I would think hard about it because I don't agree with a lot of what he's done and kind of who he stands for. But at the end of the day, it's almost, to me, it's almost like bigger than one man. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's the president and he's incredibly just... those things, you know what I'm saying? But
So it's interesting. One of the reasons why it's interesting is because she's a neo soul type artist, or I don't know if she's truly neo soul, but I put her somewhat in that category of somewhat at least neo soul ish, right? So it's interesting because you don't really see someone from the neo-soul realm actually get that type of a spotlight, you know, because we're talking about, when you think about things like the Super Bowl, like, you'll probably never see Jill Scott asked to do a Super Bowl or what have you, you know what I'm saying? But you'll see a Beyonce asked to do a Super Bowl or to do a presidential inauguration. So this could be in some way, shape, or form, by, I think your wife is watching.
Yeah,
shout out to Paul's wife, Magdala.
The one only.
So I think it could be a breakthrough moment. I also think somebody that I was listening to did say this, and I thought that was an important point, that we have to start figuring out how to not necessarily knock Trump the man. You might knock Trump the man, right? And you might feel like he personally is not... He may not be a man of character, or he might not be the type of man that you would want to hold a particular position. But at the same time, we have to be careful not to attack the position itself, right? And not to, in essence, wage war on the position itself, because that can be dangerous in and of itself, in its own way, because we, in a democracy, who you want to have the position does not always have the position.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, and that's the thing that we talked about earlier. Like, you can't, it's like the expression, you can't have your cake and eat it too. Like, you know, when Donald Trump, before the election, was talking about how, you know, he would not necessarily accept the results, you know, if he were to lose and stuff like that. Like, everybody was all in an outcry and an uproar because he was talking that way. But, you know what I'm saying, like, the Democrats are acting the same way right now. You know what I'm saying? They're all talking about, you know, illegitimate election and all these kind of things. Like, you can't,
and, they can't just and be to way. That like, point, and, we, go see, your way. We see your comment, Sharp C, and so Sharp C, just so you see real quick, she said, it's so sad. They'll hail you, then they nail you, no matter who you are. We throw the fake love around all the time, and as soon as we don't do what the majority does, we are all a sellout.
Yeah.
That's what Sharp C had to say, and then Tiff said, it's so hard to talk about him at all. So yeah. One of the things that, you know, I think that if you're going to, and this is for all of us to kind of understand, is that when we do have somebody in a position who we may not necessarily agree with and we're not fond of, we have to be careful. And unfortunately, I guess it's kind of hard to talk about it. I feel you, Tiff, on this, because you're talking about somebody who has the presidency who kind of did attack the manhood, so to speak, of President Barack Obama, who kind of led that out 8 years ago, right? And now he has the floor and sometimes gets attacked. But whenever you attack the person, to me, it does a disservice. If you're going to attack, we have to learn how to understand, like what we were talking about, what Martin Luther King was talking about, what are the actual issues at hand?
Yeah.
And are these good issues? Like, is it a legitimate issue? What's my stance on it? Do I have good, solid information as why I'm taking this position, right? And do I have good, solid information why I'm not taking the position of this person who holds the seat of presidency right now? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And then we also, in my opinion, have to understand, like, the presidency is just one aspect. If we don't understand the full range, and I'm talking to myself here also, if I don't begin to understand the full range of politics, and it's hard because it's a lot of stuff, and none of us here, none of us get paid to know this stuff, right? Yeah. So it's difficult when you got, for those of us who have a 9-to-5, right? Or for those who might have their own business and you got so much else to worry about, it's hard to say, yo, I'm gonna dedicate time to learning about the 1,000 issues that are out there to learn about, and then the different branches of government that are out there. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
But we gotta at least start trying to understand these things so that when we talk, we can say, yo, you know what? This is being brought to the table. I don't agree with it for these reasons, yeah. Right? And now I can educate you as to why I don't agree with it, and maybe you can educate me as to why you agree with it, and we can hopefully have an intelligent conversation about it, even if we disagree with each other.
Yeah, and I think a simple way is to focus on one or two issues that kind of are
true.
More important to you.
True.
You know what I'm saying?
True.
I think it can be overwhelming if you try and become a master at every single issue that's out there. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, focus on a couple of key issues that are, you know, kind of home to you, you know, close to your heart or whatever, whether it's education. You know what I'm saying? I was just watching a little bit of the Betsy DeVos, his new education secretary.
Mm-hmm.
Confirmation.
I did see
night.
Some stuff about that stirring up, but I didn't get a chance to look into it as
yet
today.
Yeah, they were getting on it. But, you know, whether it's education, whether it's, you know, economic equality or those kind of things, you know what I'm saying? Really focus on, you know, especially education is such a big deal in the African-American community or black community, you know what I'm saying, underprivileged areas and those kind of things. So, you know, I think that's a way to approach it. Like you said, you know, it's about doing it. Well, that's the thing. Like, just because that's the way Donald Trump was doesn't mean that's the way we have to be towards
right,
him.
Right,
you know what I'm saying? I don't think that,
right.
You know, like they always say, two wrongs don't make a right. You know what I'm saying? Just because that's the way he was doing
right.
it and that's the way that he does it, like he's, you know, attacking people and all those kind of things. The whole situation with John Lewis and all those kind of things, you know. But I think we have to, like Michelle Obama said in her speech, you know what I'm saying? When they go low, we go high, you know what I'm saying? I think you have to, as difficult as it is, incredibly difficult, you have to kind of rise above. Because at the end of the day, like, attacking him directly, it only fuels, it only fuels, like, the fire more, you know what I'm saying? Like, those kind of tactics, that's the kind of tactics they use throughout the entire election. Like, they never took him seriously. They always kind of belittled him. And it only, like, fueled his supporters and fueled the people that, you know, were kind of backing him. And so I think we got to maybe try and take the opposite approach. And just like you said, you know, focus on the issues, you know, focus on, you know, kind of standing up to him in, you know, in the areas where he's obviously going against the things that we believe and the values that we hold dear, and just get rid of him in the next 4 years. You know what I'm saying? Like, ultimately, that's what we got to do. Limit him to 4 years. And, you know, if you're a Democrat, you know, get your
act. Unless he actually does some real things, right?
You know, that's another question. What if he does do good things? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? What if he doesn't end up doing good things?
But at the same time, I don't think that necessarily, just because he might do some good things, doesn't mean that there shouldn't be a challenge for him to also be an example of good character, right? If what I'm saying makes sense. Because I do want to see... So we kind of talked about this last night. So the challenge is, when you don't have the person that you want in office, should you then act like, let's say, a Mitch McConnell acted and say right. something like, yo, you know what?
Just be adversary.
Yeah. Like, so Mitch McConnell's like, yo, our only thing is going to make that we're going to do for the next 4 years and 8 years is to make sure Barack Obama has a failed presidency, right?
Yeah.
So you have that one aspect, but then you also have the other aspect of you know, should we do that to President Trump if we don't? And when I say that, I'm asking everybody, like, if whenever you have somebody in office who you don't agree with, do you just sit back and say, yo, we're just going to do everything that we can to make sure that they fail, right? And we talked about that, like, sometimes when we're, the challenge with politics is that you're juggling this idealist, like, this idealist mindset that you have, like, in a perfect world, things would look like this, but then you also have to think about the practical, right? Because sometimes you're trying to figure out, yo, things should be this way. Like, somebody should be in position who I trust their character and the policy decisions that they're making, right? But there might be times where somebody might, they might do some policy stuff that you agree with, but their character, you might call that into question a bit. And it's like, well, do I not do anything with this person because their character isn't what I want it to be? You know, because real people are affected by that. There are real people who are going to go hungry based on policies, y'all. You know what I'm saying? Like, the practical stuff. Like, there are real people who are going to die, lose their lives because of policy. There are real people who are, you know, they're, we were talking about
healthcare.
Yeah, when you or like when Keith Ellis was talking about WIC, right? And he was like, yo, WIC, so for mothers who might be struggling, WIC doesn't cover things like diapers, right? And so, and the expensive cost of diapers. So there are policies that literally affect the day-to-day life of people, right? Healthcare. Yeah. Somebody might not have healthcare. That's the difference between them staying alive and being here to fight in politics in the future, or being dead. Like, it impacts people for real, you know? So how do we figure out this thing on a practical level? But what I was saying, my original point was that, even though we might say, even if somebody does figure certain things out on the practical level, I still think it's valuable for us to challenge our leaders and ourselves to be people who say, yo, you know what? On the character front, let's challenge each other to do better too. Because if somebody's looking at the president, they are looking at that person as an example of character. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So if your president is beating up on the people who he represents, you know what I'm saying? Like, if anything, your president is the person that you want to know also cares about the people that do not agree with him.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And because then you run into the possibility of one day having something that says, like, yo, okay, anybody who doesn't agree with me is my enemy, and away with them. And that's what we, all through the history, that's been the challenge. A leader who, and we still see it today.
Yeah.
If we look in other areas of the world where a leader might come into power and says, yo, these people, they don't agree with me, so they're the enemy.
Yeah.
So then we get rid of them.
That's kind of how we're acting. I mean, that's, you know, politics has become so polarized that, you know, it's just me against you. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's no common ground anymore. Mm-hmm. And like you said, I think we got to get back to focusing on the issues, man. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that I agree with you on the character premise, mm-hmm. but I think it's a dangerous line to kind of or path to go down mm-hmm. because ultimately everybody's flawed. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? And so if you start to kind of eliminate people or mm-hmm. try and, you know, disqualify them because mm-hmm. of certain character flaws, mm-hmm. I think, you know,
potentially,
yeah, you gotta look in the mirror first, you know what I'm saying? You know, so just because you're absolutely. Not seeing their absolutely. Character flaws doesn't mean that, absolutely. You know, so I would be careful with
well,
that.
Well,
but
well, not to eliminate them for the because of their character flaw, but to just challenge them to ever increasingly be going after a better character, for lack of a better way of putting it, at this particular point in time.
Trying to sanctify
right?
them.
Not trying to sanctify them, right? You know what I'm saying? But just challenging and saying, listen, we all do come with flaws, but you would hope that our nation has always been about how do we become better. Matter of fact, that's one of the reasons why we left. So when we talk about the beginning, the birth of our nation, was founded on, and we know that there's some shady stuff it was founded on too, right? But originally, we talk about the religious unrest that was going on in the European areas. Why? Because there were leaders who, based if anybody didn't agree with them as on a religious front, they would basically be persecuted, right? Yeah. So they decided to come on over to the New World based on that to say, yo, like, how can we have new opportunity and open up new opportunity? Why? Because when you think about it, it was a character issue, right? And so they were like, yo, how can we build this place where people can be free to practice whatever they want? And it was somewhat a character issue why this nation was developed. Now, certainly wasn't perfect, but we've always challenged and said, yo, how do we become better in character? So we start off by saying, okay, boom, first thing, religion. The next thing, yo, we got this slavery issue, and we're still dealing with it today, but we certainly, little by little, made strides. We can actually be here talking about these issues now where we couldn't have done that 100 years ago, right? So there's always this evolving challenge that our characters would be better, right? And so I think that we should be able to challenge our president that as far as character, we're not going to disqualify you because of your character, but let's also challenge you to ever increase your character and while we do the same.
Be more of a role model.
Yeah. Anyway, we'll leave it at that. Real quick, as we close, recommendation. Yeah. Hit them with a recommendation. What any recommendations that you have
for me? I can't really recommend it in terms of I haven't read it yet, but the next book I'm going to read is called Evicted. Mm. It's supposed to be a really incredible book about, you know, kind of the housing crisis, housing situations. Mm. And so, yeah, I'm looking forward to reading that. It's been highly recommended by people that I listen to, so
yeah,
I'm going to check it out. Yeah.
A couple of them for me, The Dan We Trust, that capitalism and democracy are not designed to work together. Yo,
we've been having that conversation. Hold on,
we might have to have that conversation next week for real on air. That's big. My recommendation, I would suggest if y'all go to Netflix, there's two things. I watched the Evolution of Hip Hop, which is a documentary on kind of the birth of hip hop, and it really goes into, you know, just the conditions in the Bronx that led to the development of hip hop. You know, when you talk about DJ Kool Herc, you know, and then from DJ Kool Herc to moving into African Bambaataa, and then what's my man's name? That's crazy. Y'all know who I'm talking about, though. The big three out of New York. But really understanding the conditions at the time. Disco was big, but then all of a sudden it moved from disco over into hip hop by accident almost, you know. But the conditions, and then it's called The Get Down. It's not a documentary. But it's another thing that talks about hip hop, but it's kind of like in a story form. And it's real dope, man. And you just see like kind of like the bugged out conditions of the Bronx at that time, and what people were really dealing with and struggling with. whether it be racial issues. And, it's funny because one of the things I thought about talking about today was the opioid epidemic going on. And it's interesting how when you had the opioid epidemic, you have this opioid epidemic going on right now, and it's being talked about as kind of like a disease. And, you know, and it's the people in the government are talking about, okay, how do we help these people? But when you had a similar epidemics going on, like crack and cocaine, heroin and all this stuff in the major cities where it was heavily black populated back in like the late 70s and the 80s, it wasn't talked about in that same way. It was talked about as if these people were criminals. There was no voice coming from the government saying like, yo, you know what, we gotta figure out a way to help these people or what have you. You know, so I'm reading that. I watched those things. I finally read Of Mice and Men, as some of y'all see on my Instagram. Most of y'all read that in high school. My girlfriend happened to have it, and I just decided I was going to read it. So I know Paul got to get out of here. He got to go play for a prayer meeting at church or what have you. Oh, another thing I've been doing actually is, some of y'all know that I'm a pastor also, so one of the things I've really been doing is combing through the four Gospels really lately and trying to just do, that is gas. But I've been really trying to take the Gospels and figure out like how do I really make it very, very practical, the history of them practical and all the nuances practical for the person who's never gonna get that deep into, let's say, Bible reading or what have you, man. So that's something that I'm doing right now. So
One last book. Yo, A.W. Tozer. I love his writing, but I have a... Oh, man. Oh, shoot. What's the name of that book? Oh, man.
While you're trying
I'll
to
bring it next time.
A.W. Tozer. Another one, Food Choices. Y'all know I'll be watching like or listening to like random stuff. So on Netflix, Food Choices, it's really pushed me to get back into healthy eating, you know, as much as is possible, getting rid of the meat. Getting rid of processed foods, trying to get back to just like fruits, vegetables as much as possible. You found it?
Yeah, The Purpose of Man, Designed to Worship.
Mm.
Beautiful book.
Okay, beautiful book. Okay, so yeah. I forgot my notebook. Y'all know I usually have my notebook. I forgot it this week. Otherwise, I had a bunch of like recommendations for y'all. Some dope stuff, I think,
yeah,
also.
Let the people go, man.
But yeah, we're going to be out of here. Fed Up on Netflix is along those lines too. Okay, is that another food one, Tiff? Paul, you get out of here because I know you got to go play for prayer meeting. I'll wrap up with them.
All right. Peace.
Peace out, Paul.
I'll be back. Look.
It's about food. All right. I'm going to check that out.